Blog Talk Radio.
Om Shabbat Shalom, holy way of the Most High. Om Shabbat Shalom, I sense your presence. Om Shabbat Shalom, holy way of the Most High. Om Shabbat Shalom, I sense your presence. And I am the light within your soul, in the essence of truth and right, love makes the circle whole. And here we stand in line, waiting for some sacred sign, but to find the balance is the purpose of this time. To restore the balance of the universal mind. And in the presence of my Lord of light and love, everything I see aspiring to be free. And when I call to thee, and come on bended knee, surrender to the all-pervading light and love. Reflections of the one surrounding me with love. And I sense your presence. I sense your presence. I sense your presence. I sense your presence. Within and without, above and below, yeah. East, west, north and south, I sense your presence. Without and within, below and above, yeah, yeah. East, west, north and south, I sense your presence. I sense your presence. Lord of light and love, everything I find in tune with the divine. And here we stand in line, waiting for some sacred sign, but to find the balance is the purpose of this time. To restore the balance of the universal mind. I am the light within your soul, in the essence of truth and right, love makes the circle whole. And when I call to thee, and come on bending knee, surrender to the all-pervading light and love. Reflections of the one surrounding me with love. For to find the balance is the purpose of this time. To restore the balance of the universal mind. And I sense your presence. I sense your presence. I sense your presence. I sense your presence. Om Shabbat Shalom, holy way of the Most High. Om Shabbat Shalom, I sense your presence. Om Shabbat Shalom, holy way of the Most High. Om Shabbat Shalom, I sense your presence. Om Shabbat Shalom, holy way of the Most High. Om Shabbat Holy angel of the Most High, Om Shabbat Shalom, I sense your presence. I sense your presence.
Thank you for joining me tonight here on Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour. My name is Jessie Ann Nichols George, and I am your hostess. The music you were listening to there at the beginning of the show is I Sense Your Presence. It's by Shemshai. Shemshai is a group that I used to know from Arizona, and they are now traveling worldwide. When I first met them, they just had one little CD out, and now they've got a whole bunch, and it's pretty exciting, all the events that they're doing right now. I want to say welcome to those, whether you're returning or whether you're coming in for the first time to listen to the show here. And I appreciate you being here and listening with us tonight here at Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour. I look at the different ways that compassion exists in our lives, how to remove our blocks, resistances, frustrations, and more. And some weeks I'm discussing different aspects of how compassion is in our life, how it affects our life, and the different areas of compassion. And then some weeks I'm doing more exercises or implementations. And a lot of times what I've got on this year is guests coming on the show, like tonight. And that way it gives you a chance to learn about their work as well as how other things complement and work with compassion. And I will be highlighting different musical artists from time to time along the way. For example, just a few weeks ago, I had Stephen Halpern on the show. If you missed that, you might want to go back and catch that show. As well as Claire Hedin was on at the end of last year, another great show to go back and catch in the archives. And then every now and then I throw in a coaching night where you can call in and receive coaching assistance for free. So that's a pretty cool option as well here on the show. Now remember, when you're sharing your experiences, you help others as well. And I also in my own work focus on helping people find and use compassion in their everyday lives. So I like to take this big concept and bring it into our everyday lives where it's able to be implemented easily. I also created the Genesis Clearing Statement, which some of you may have experienced on previous shows. And if you've missed that, you can also catch that in the archives. I've authored two books so far titled Activating Compassion and also Activating Compassion, the Workbook. In addition, I've created the Compassion Tour, which is a multi-state nationwide tour, including workshops, retreats, seminars, book signings, and fundraising events. And if you want to follow what's happening with tour events, you can keep up on that at jessieannicholsgeorge.eventbrite.com. And whenever I have new events going up, I post them right there for you to take advantage of. I've also got there an option called Gifting the Tour. For those people that are unable to attend, say, any of the events, but they'd like to support the work I'm doing, maybe help me get out to some of the fundraisers. When I do the fundraisers, 90% of what I bring in on the event goes to the organization. So that's a really useful thing. And also a reminder, if you enjoy the show, make certain that you share it with your friends, your family, significant others, and all of those wonderful social media connections out there, or anybody else that you just feel inspired to share it with. They can always listen to it in the archives. They come right into the same link that you use to get into the show, and they'll be able to listen to it. In addition, they can either go to my Facebook Activating Compassion page, which is at facebook.com/activatingcompassion/notes, and they can also go onto my webpage at jessieannicholsgeorge1.com. And all the archive shows are on both of those locations as well. Now, before I get started tonight, I always like to tap into the 72 Names of God, Technology for the Soul by Yehuda Berg, and just see what our message is for the week. It's one of those things that I like to do randomly, and I always find that the message applies to things that we're dealing with this week, to our guests, to the message that we have to share. And this message, whatever I pull here, by the way, I do also post on my website on my Main Street Universe Jessie Ann Nichols George page. And that way you can always go back and read it as well during the week and take the time to really absorb the concept that's here. So what I do is I randomly just open in the book here because I find that's the fun way to get messages. That's when it really applies. And just see what we have for tonight here. And, this is going to be an interesting one, especially given our guest tonight, global transformation. And the little saying that goes with global transformation tonight, there's actually a little quote here from John Lennon and Paul McCartney. It says, "You say you want a revolution. Well, you know, we all want to change the world." Now, the insight that Yehuda provides for this message is world peace begins with the individual. Before we can change the human condition, we must change ourselves. It is often easy to rally around a cause. It is far more difficult to look in the mirror and begin the work of inner transformation. If a beggar is in need of $5 and a passerby has only a nickel, he cannot fulfill the beggar's needs. In other words, we can share only what we possess. Before we can embark on a mission to change the world, we must first transform ourselves, change our ways, and attain true joy and fulfillment in our own lives. And if there is any doubt whatsoever that we ourselves still require further correcting, bear in mind that the harsh Kabbalistic truth, that which our eyes witness out in the external world, all the evil, all the wickedness, is but a mirror image, reflecting the remains of evil that lay hidden and undetected in our hearts. Reflect upon the spiritual truth, and this is his meditation now, reflect upon the spiritual truth that world peace begins with peace in your own heart. With this name, you speed your own transformation and strengthen the forces of peace throughout the world. And the name that we have here for global transformation is pronounced Ayin Shen Lamed. Okay, that's Ayin Shen Lamed, and that's global transformation is the name of God that we're calling on tonight. So there you go. We really appreciate that message from Yehuda Berg. And I encourage you, like I said, if you want to, you can always go on my website and look it up, and it will be there. Now, as we start to move into our topic tonight and with our guest, I find today that it seems that people have gotten really busy making things complicated as we develop as a society. And we keep adding apps, social media sites, more options for things. And even in this time of great awareness building through massive dispersing of information, people express feeling lost, confused, uncertain as they try to take in all the different pieces of insight, information, and considerations. However, is this still living outside of ourselves? Have we become so complicated in our attempts to be aware? What if life was really simple? Now, let me point out, simple may not always be easy. And for some, being simple can be quite challenging. Most belief systems feel that we are in some way moving into consciousness, uniting with divine presence, or becoming who we truly are. People often wonder what they should be doing and how they can truly progress into the spiritual self. And what if it was truly as simple as 1, 2, 3 steps? What if all we really had to accomplish in order to have it all is 3 things? I have to wonder, if we did shift our focus on that, how much our lives would change. And my thoughts are that we would do things much different than we're doing them now, especially if this focus was done as a collective. Right back there into that global transformation, right? Richard Harvey has identified these steps. And our guest tonight focuses on a component of compassion that is related to the aspect in my books that is in the chapter, Finding Your Truth. And it is where we start to really tune in to who we are, what we want to give to this world, what we want to be in this world. It is about knowing yourself. And in knowing ourselves and standing in that energy, it is as important part, or is an important part, I should say, of releasing what holds us back. It's an important part of enjoying life and an important part in progressing forward. I'm going to take a short break, and when we return, I will have Richard Harvey with us. He's going to be sharing his work on understanding ourselves and learning how to be free from fear and desire. The song I have for you during our break is called Dia Harmonies. It's by Claire Hedin. She was on my show again at the end of December last year. It was the last show of 2012. So you can, again, check that out in the archives. And if you'd like to find out more about Claire's work, you can go on to her website, which is www.clairehedin.com. And that's CLAREHEDIN.com. And we'll be back in just a couple of minutes.
Oh, dear, dear little light, shine forth thy beauty. You came, you went, 'twas brief and rare. We loved you, and we love you. So thank you. Yes, thank you, we thank you, oh, so deeply. And thank you, yes, thank you, we thank you for your visit. We know your time with us was brief, but still 'twas time well valued. You have a place in hearts and minds down here on earthly fallows. Your light will shine and dance you will upon the skies of spirit. We learn, we love, we touch, we part, we feel the healing. So thank you, yes, thank you, we thank you, oh, so deeply. And thank you, yes, thank you, we thank you for your visit. Oh, dear, dear little light, shine forth thy beauty. You came, you went, 'twas brief and rare. We loved you and we love you. So thank you, yes, thank you, dear, dear, sweet in spirit. And thank you, yes, thank you, we thank you for your visit.
Welcome back. You are listening to Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour. My name is Jessie Ann Nichols George, and I am your hostess this evening. You were just listening to Dia Harmonies, and that's by Claire Hedin. Again, if you'd like to find out more about her music, you can go onto our website at www.clairehedin.com. That's CLAREHEDIN.com. Now, I'd like to be bringing on my guest here tonight, and I want to just give you a little introduction to him. His name is Richard Harvey, and Richard is a psychotherapist, author, and spiritual teacher. He is the founder director of Therapy and Spirituality, a personal and spiritual growth center, which is situated in the Sierra Nevada mountains in Spain. His background is in humanistic and transpersonal psychologies, Taoism, and Zen. He is trained in Western psychology and Eastern meditative methods, psychospiritual psychotherapy, and body work. He is the author of The Flight of Consciousness, as well as several other books and articles focused on realizing our true selves. His innovative approach to human development, The Three Stages of Awakening, is discussed in his latest book, Your Essential Self, which will be published by Llewellyn Worldwide in July 2013. We will be looking at his work tonight of how he blends therapy and spirituality to help people release restrictive emotional behavior patterns and embrace positive opportunities for growth and change. You can learn more about Richard on his website, which is www.therapyandspirituality.com. Again, that is therapyandspirituality.com. I'm going to go ahead and open up his mic this evening. Hello, Richard. It's wonderful to have you here tonight on Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour.
Hi, Jesse.
I know it's morning for you. It's still night for us here.
It's early morning here.
Well, I really appreciate you giving your time to us. And I wanted to start just by having you share a little bit about your story. Who's Richard, and how did Richard get into what he's doing with this work now?
You know, when I answer that kind of question, I can either go with the Richard who started in the 70s, in what in Europe was called the Human Potential Movement, and I think also in the States. And I came in then when I was a young man, at the 20s. But, you know, the other way of answering the question is I've really always been like this. I mean, since I was very young, from when I can remember as a very young child, I was searching. I had an overall feeling of not really belonging. And it took me 20 years and so on to discover a milieu, discover an environment and a group of people where I felt like somehow I was a part of something, and something that fitted and suited me. So I didn't have the words, I didn't have the context, I didn't have the a background for thought and philosophy and what I eventually realized was spiritual searching until my early 20s, when I fell in with a lot of amazing people, really. In Europe, the first human potential centers for what we called at that time new therapies. Meditation was just beginning. There was a meeting of Eastern and Western thought, and it was an extraordinary time to be involved in something that we had enormous hope that would change the world. And one of my one of the ways in which I didn't fit in was in the 60s and the early 70s. Of course, people were very concerned with changing the world in the outward sense, and that never seemed to me to be valid. It always seemed to me something was missing, because I felt very strongly there was an element of projection from the inner to the outer, and that somehow the inner was most important. And I have, I mean, I feel that more strongly today than ever. So this was me. I started into my own inner journey very young, probably too young in some ways, but it was wonderful for me, early 20s. And by the time I was in my late 20s, I was a psychotherapist. I was teaching meditation. I was running workshops. And it wasn't until 21 years of practice and so on that I felt that I could actually write something that was worth recording, that may be of use, which was in The Flight of Consciousness, my first book. And now I'm particularly happy because it's been a long process of about 12 years bringing to fruition this present book, which is finally my insight that there was a middle stage, shall we say, between the spiritual person and the person who is dealing with individual psychology. And that middle stage is I call authenticity, but in a special way. And it's really characterized by compassion and a heart-centered life.
And I think this is very exciting, because I do want to delve a little bit more into both of those books and where the concepts are at, because I think you have so much within them there that can be shared. And it's interesting, after the message I had at the beginning of the show from the 72 Names of God, that you're also kind of reinforcing it. It starts from the inside, and I think that's such a valuable piece that people oftentimes forget or they don't think about. They're so busy trying to change their outer world. They're so busy trying to feed the world and take care of everybody, and they forget that it starts inside. It starts from our own self, and the outer world is going to respond or react to what's happening internally with us.
And, you know, in a way you can see it. I like sometimes to be really practical. I mean, you get up in the morning and you have a certain mindset, don't you? You wake up in a certain way, in a certain attitude. And, you know, I will see several people in a day just in my practice, and it's quite interesting because the way in which you have approached the day has dictated the experience. And then as a therapist, a person will bring that experience to me, and then in a way we may take it back and say, well, this in a sense is what you expected. This in a sense is what you started out with. You really did create your own world, and there was another way that you could have done it, but you didn't. It was like that. And on a smaller scale, then, I think we can see, if you meet the day aggressively, for example, the day is full of conflict and it's full of frustration. You meet it another way, it's entirely transformed. So that's the smaller version of, because this message you read out at the beginning was, as you said, extraordinarily relevant and very significant to me. The theme of global transformation begins with the individual.
And it's true, and I think this is an important piece too, in the sense that a lot of people get overwhelmed when they're focusing on that big global level, and they forget all they really have to do is concern themselves with themselves. And if they take care of themselves and everybody took care of themselves, everything would naturally transform.
Yeah, I'm reminded of what did Ramana Maharshi say? You know, everybody knows the ocean contains a drop, but fewer people
right.
know the drop contains the ocean. So, you know, it really is like that. If you look inside yourself, see the universe. I mean, in a sense, what you're doing is dispelling the illusion of separation.
Right.
You know, so when I embark on my day as if I'm in some way separate or divisive, the conflict ensues. If I walk out, if I begin my day at one, there is no separation. There are no groups of individuals. We are all really cells of Gaia, which is or the universe. We're all connected, of course. So these are different ways of looking at things.
And it's really interesting, I think, when we take that perspective. If we could wake up and start the day off in this aspect and this frame of mind of just saying, it's going to be an incredible day today. It's going to be incredible. That's how my day is going to go.
Yeah.
We set it in motion for everything to happen because our brain is deciding and realizing, yes, this is how it's going to happen. When we see other people and we come across other people in our day, I feel like it's a great chance, again, that reflection, as was kind of mentioned in the passage earlier, is realizing that when somebody's hurting, when somebody's reacting, that we're coming across in our day, that in a sense that's really a piece of ourselves that's saying, hey, I need some help here. And if we look at that other person as ourself, instead of just another person, like you said, as one, that's where we look at them as one versus two separate things, we actually can accomplish much stronger because we look at them and realize, oh, this person is hurting. They're not trying to hurt me. They're just hurting.
Yes.
And how do I heal myself? And I think that's a great launching point as we start to move in. I would love for you to share a bit about your book, The Flight of Consciousness, which is The Flight of Consciousness, a contemporary map for the spiritual journey. And as you said, this was kind of your foundations that you were starting from when you started writing. And I know that this book is about a sacred journey and is the deepening into ourselves, but I'd love for you to share that.
The Flight of Consciousness came out, it was a direct response to the confusion that so many people in not only the personal growth field, but also in the spiritual field, were experiencing in relationship to the plethora of publications on spirituality. You know, if you go back now only 30 years, we had very few books. You know, 35 years, we had very few books on self-help or even the old classic texts like the Bhagavad Gita and so on that were available to us. There just weren't that many. And if you had, you know, read several handfuls of books, 20, 30 books, there wasn't an awful lot more. Maybe a few more than 20 or 30, but not a lot. Today, of course, there's walls and walls of this stuff, and you can't possibly keep up with reading all of it. But what happened 20 years or so ago, in my experience anyway, I don't know how general this is and if you can identify this, but people were experiencing a lot of confusion on very basic concepts to do with psychospirituality. For example, perhaps the preeminent one is the word self. And you would have a word like self, and it would be equated with the soul or the spirit or, of course, the individual personality or character. And then reading across books on psychology and spirituality, there would be disagreement in the definition, and which itself would lead to conflict within the field, which was absurd.
Right.
So I would read these things, and somehow they were transparent to me. I mean, I had a sort of healthy sort of rebelliousness. I'm not going to subordinate myself to a book. You know, any of these books were somebody's view, I don't really care how old they were, of the truth. And they were then, of course, sometimes corrupted in translation, and sometimes rendered according to, you know, editorship and so on. I wrote The Flight of Consciousness, therefore, to say, look, it's kind of like this. There's these stages you pass through personality and then to high states of spiritual consciousness. And this is sort of how they connect. And this is the relevance of the scriptures and the books, whether modern or ancient, in relationship to this journey. I was saying, in a way, let's just make it practical. Let's just bring it down to earth. You know, your experience is as valid as anybody else's. And the general movement of it, because, you know, everyone's journey is unique. And yet at the same time, to say anything intelligent about it, you have to generalize. And so I would bring in The Flight of Consciousness, references to Hinduism, mystical Christianity, Buddhism, and so on and so on and so on, to correlate them and say, look, we don't need to be confused. This is what it means. And essentially what it means is that you are free. You work through your personality to discover you're free. And then there's certain things which absolutely must happen for you to expand from the individual, separate, separative, divisive, conflictual self, which isn't the reality. It's a relative reality. And here's how it relates to the absolute reality. So The Flight of Consciousness was an attempt, really, to bring it all together, you know, and to say, you know, this is the fundamental sense that it makes, and that fundamental sense is that you are free, you are love, you can realize yourself, and yes, you do have to work on your individual self-sense to do that.
And I'm glad that that is your perspective, because I know that's one of the things I do in writing, is taking these big concepts and bringing them down to where they're in everyday language for people.
Mm.
And I found in my studies through the years, a lot of what you're saying here is that the truth is in the overlap. And when you get down to the cores and the fundamentals, no matter what belief system it's coming from, basically they're all the same. And it comes down to a few core fundamental principles there. I was wondering, too, Richard, if you could share maybe a little bit of part of that process of what needs to happen for somebody. Once they realize they're free, they discover that they're free, and then you said that there are things that need to happen in order for somebody to expand or realize themselves.
Yeah, you have to really take apart the personality and the character in relationship to the small self. And you know, I use these terms very specifically. Again, they're terms, as you know, I'm sure, that are used in many different ways, but you know, we don't need to get, that's a long discussion. The way in which I use it
telling people, like, do we really have to be this hung up on terms?
and this complex.
Right.
I mean, then we get into, you know, for a while there, I was into comparative religion or comparative psychology. I mean, it's endlessly fascinating, but it's a linear progression. You don't go anywhere. You go sideways for an awful long time, or for the whole of your life, of course. But anyway, that's not what we're talking about. You have to cultivate awareness, first of all, to see the small self, the ego self. You come to realize that there is no small self or ego self. It's not an entity. It's a misnomer. What it is it's a process. It's something that's happening, and it's happening because you kickstart it from the beginning of your day, and you hold on to it, and you maintain it throughout your day, of course. So I prefer to use the term these days, ego processes. Although it's longer, it's just more precise. There is no ego. It's a Wizard of Oz thing. You know, there's just an appearance through these processes of something far grander than it is. And of course, just this work, this practice of developing awareness to the degree that you can see yourself, not as yourself, but as you appear to be, as you're acting, you know, through your self-importance, through your self-defense, your self-aggrandizement, selfishness and self-absorption and all of this, is very hard. I mean, it takes a while. It's helpful to have a teacher. It's helpful to be consistent. But the first thing, without any doubt, in my mind, is you cultivate awareness. And you cultivate awareness, and you cultivate awareness, and you keep it going, and you notice where you drop out of awareness. And what, of course, eventually happens as you develop awareness is it becomes the position that you're in, rather than the ego processes, rather than being the small self, this identified historical memory of somebody progressing through a life and more or less not really changing, although you dazzle yourself with experience, of course, you take up and stabilize in the position of awareness, which is kind of, you know, as I sometimes describe to people, is kind of a bit behind and above. It's sort of, it almost feels, from the bodily perspective, like it has a physical location. Of course, it doesn't really. It's everywhere. But from the bodily perspective, it's kind of back there and up. And what it does is it gives you a kind of super view of everything. You see over everything. And you yourself, of course, become included. And that's when you know you're getting someplace, because you're seeing yourself all the time, just like you're seeing the objects in front of you. And it becomes apparent the function of personality and character. And character, in the way I use it, simply means defense. It's simply character is simply armoring for the small self or for the ego processes. It obfuscates or it makes opaque. It means you cannot see through to what's really going on. And the personality, of course, then is the way in which we express that, or you might say the way in which we avoid meeting or repel life, or deny ourselves intimacy with others, but with nature, with things, with the outside world. And, of course, correspondingly, because this takes so much of our energy, time and attention, even intimacy with, or particularly really, intimacy with ourselves. So this is the first stage, and what I'm one of the things I'm refining at the moment is something that I call, it's a little bit of a mouthful, but I call it the central character dynamic, because it's the pivot or the hub on which everything in personality, character, and the ego processes is based. It's rather like finding the middle of the wheel. And when you locate that, of course, you have a lot more power over the movement of it all. It really amounts to very few words or a short concept, but you're saying, here is the very middle of my characterful existence. And it can be something very simple, or it can be complex. It really depends on the person. When you've discovered that, then you really are a step up on personality and character and the ego. You know that you can now deconstruct everything you've previously believed about yourself. I'm moving on a bit quick because it's long, but the end of this first stage of the process, and this is comprises the first stage of my book, Your Essential Self, is two critically important stages, and one is forgiveness. And I know forgiveness has been talked about, you know, endlessly, and it's been talked about because it's so desirable, but it seriously, it's not enough to want to forgive. You have to be in a position where you truly can forgive. And in my model, because this is my experience, It comes very late in the individual journey, because we're not equipped to really let go and assume that gigantic responsibility for ourselves and our world by letting go of having anybody anymore to blame. So it's huge, and it is the penultimate stage of the individual journey. And it brings about the state of wholeness. State of wholeness is the complete acceptance of oneself as you are. Warts and all, darkness, light and all, love, anger, hate and all, everything is completely accepted. And in that, of course, you accept also the world, you accept the universe.
And I think this is really is a great aspect that people don't think about. I love your term of deconstructing the self, because that is really a point of where we're saying, okay, I'm letting go of all that outside programming from the world. I'm letting go of what the ego is trying to force on me. And I'm taking responsibility for my actions. There's no more excuses. No matter what comes up in life, I'm not going to use it as an excuse. My question then starts becoming, for example, now what do I do? How do I move to the next step? What's an alternative route? As opposed to saying, well, I can't get there, I can't do it. And I also love that you bring up the aspect of you can't just want to do it. You have to get out and do it. And that's a piece that people miss. They think, oh, but I want to do this. I want to do this. Okay, that's great that you want to, but what are you doing to make that happen? What are you doing to take those steps? And so even though that might be a starting point, and there is such a huge transformation that occurs, and I think anybody who has gotten to that point to where they are no longer making excuses for things starts to really feel that wholeness that you talk about.
Yeah. The other thing that I would add is you, it's not enough to want, you have to do it, but you have to be, I think the word is know yourself. I mean, you have to have the self-knowledge to know that you're not adding another covering, you know. One of the stories I think I included in the book, Your Essential Self, was a young woman who helped me enormously with this, who had read widely on the forgiveness literature, of which, you know, we've got lots because we intuit that it's very desirable. And it is very desirable, of course, and it's extraordinarily important. But what is so undesirable is to give yourself a step, or to try and enter a stage you're just not ready for. And this young woman was so intent on forgiveness, but she wasn't ready. I mean, I didn't know that at the time immediately, but I realized it as we worked together, that she, of course, she wanted to forgive all sorts of people in her life, but she wasn't, she hadn't done the work yet. She wasn't there yet.
Mm-hmm.
And it's painful, you know, because you have to say, well, yeah, these are good intentions, and hold that aspiration. It's critical, it's so important, it's wonderful, but you know, just now you've got to be doing this. and you have to be doing what you have to be doing, you know. I mean, crass though that sounds, it's maybe really important to remember you have to be doing what you have to be doing. It arises naturally.
And that's an interesting piece that you bring up as well, that I think a lot of people don't look at, is that factor that of knowing the self. Because if, for example, you've got all these people out there sharing information and they don't know their self. They're just reciting everybody else's work. So there comes a piece, too, in that I feel that you can go out and you can do a lot of things, but if you don't know yourself in the process of doing those things, and I don't want to discourage people from going out and trying to do things, because I think to a certain extent they can find themselves in that process of doing. They learn and they discover more about themselves, and then that helps them along, and that helps them know how to do more or differently or more consciously. And yet at the same time, when you do from a space of knowing, there's so much confidence, there's so much, I don't know, empowerment maybe, is a word that's used a lot today, from that space. You're coming from a space of not questioning, not doubting. You just know. You're in vibration, or you're in alignment
that
knowing.
That's right. And what happens, I think, is that, you see, we lead our lives through thought. It's what I've come to call the first dark veil, because it's very hard to see through the veil of thought. And everything in the life, when it's unexamined or towards the beginning of the process of self-discovery, is thought. And that's why we can think ourselves into forgiveness, which isn't genuine, but it's a thought of forgiveness. And, you know, it's a viable aspiration, it's a good idea and everything, but it's just not a reality, it's not a possibility early on. And this veil of thought, one of the important matters I find about it is you need a guide at some point. At some point, however much work we do on ourselves, you need somebody to fill those gaps in. And I remember my own teacher would, from time to time, he would say to me, do this now. And I think, God, I hadn't even thought of that. And looking back, I can see that he knew exactly what the step was that I could now take or needed to take, or the direction I needed to turn in. And I wouldn't have had a clue, because I was thinking my way through life largely. And so when if I read something, I thought, that sounds really good, you know, I think I'll do that, you know, I better do Zen meditation, or I better read the Bhagavad Gita, or I better, you know, something or other that I thought was a good idea. But he would be there to say, no, do that now. And I had trust enough that I would follow that, even though I didn't know why. And I have that experience now with people who I work with, where I sometimes will just make a suggestion, not even necessarily knowing myself what the justification may be of it, and I say, no, do that. And it turns out to be the right step, you know?
I think that's very true and very important, and I know that the different teachers I've had along the way have been able to fill in, and not only filled in the gaps for me, but helped me learn how to integrate the pieces. And I feel very blessed that way, that I had those teachers that taught me to not just take the information, but to really experience it, feel it, and integrate it with everything else that I knew. And to look at a set of different pieces and see how they would fit together. So I think that that is important, to have those teachers that help you get to those spaces along the way. And those teachers come in all different forms. They might come in a traditional form of somebody who's really well noted out there. They might be that hidden person in the neighborhood. They come in a lot of different shapes and forms and personalities and styles. And so I think that is important there. And I also had another piece there in my head that I was thinking about in the midst of all of that. But as you say, you know, it's not enough to just read something. It's about really absorbing it internally. And I think realizing that some of these little pieces that we've gotten along the way, or things that we've done along the way, it may not fully click in till later, and that this process and how things come about and how we learn them, this is a little bit different for everybody.
Mm. No, and isn't that good? I mean, that's just a wonderful thing, because, you know, people really are unique. We really are diverse. This is one of these spiritual psychological truths that you have to bear in mind, I think, which is that what I've just said is true and it's not true, and it depends where you're looking at it from. So when you're looking at it from point of view of the world full of diverse, unique individuals, there's a wonderful thing going on, which is that somehow we're all different. Somehow we all manifest differently in different forms and different characters and different colors and feeling and so on. And you know that, and it's a wonderful thing about the world. Therefore, the great variety of psychospiritual means that we have today, and we have today more variety of means than ever before, because we're not constricted now by the culture. We don't have to be Christian in a Christian country, or, you know, Muslim in an Islamic country, or whatever. We just don't. We have it all. It's not true for everybody, of course, but if I may speak of the Western world anyway, you know, we have that freedom. And from the point of view, though, of the spiritual stages, of course, that uniqueness is expressions of the sameness of all of us. We're all actually the same. There's no difference. We are all actually compassion, or we're all consciousness, or we're all God. And there's no difference between you and I, you and anybody else, in the spiritual sense. But the way in which we manifest that essence, that's unique to the individual.
And I think that that's a valuable piece when people are taking a journey in life, when they are walking to learn, to develop themselves, to understand themselves, because that's really what a spiritual path is about understanding ourselves, is to realize that you don't have to do it the same way as everybody else, that the way I do it is not going to be exactly the same way you do it. I might need different pieces to fill in than you need to fill in, and vice versa. And so I think there's an important message there of not comparing ourselves to where somebody else is at or what somebody else is doing, because we all carry that unique piece, even though we're all integrated in one at the same time.
That's right. I mean, it's lovely to read about the lives of great adepts over thousands of years. We can read about them, and what you notice, what I notice about them, is they're full of character. I mean, they're full of self in a sense. They are individual, they're unique, and you get a flavor. I mean, if you read the life of one adept and you compare it to the other, you can see that the personal traits can be entirely different. But, of course, they're manifesting through the individual life the same truth, should we say, the same consciousness, the same reality. And you can feel that too. So you kind of turn tables on the personality, on the character, so it becomes subordinate to the truth or subordinate to who you really are. And it doesn't mean you're... Because this question, I don't know about you, but this question is asked of me very often, you know, well, what happens to the character? What's going to happen to the personality, you know, when I'm enlightened or something? Or if I meditate for too long, will I become tasteless and characterless and sort of blank or something?
And of course, boring and dull and entire 24/7.
Yeah, just no life and no enthusiasm. And I don't know about you, Jesse, but my experience is the further you go, the more that is the case, the more characterful, the more colorful, the more enlivened the person is as an individual entity. And of course, the difference, and this is the thing to emphasize, I think, is it's not a matter of outward appearance, it's not a matter of expression, it's a matter of attachment. So the thing to remember, and I think it's inherent in the lives of the great adepts over the last few thousand years, is what I intuit is these are people who are manifesting the totality or the whole or love, compassion, not as as relative states, but they themselves have no attachment to the individual separate self, which gives you a tremendous freedom, actually, to be yourself, oddly, paradoxically.
It's so true. It is one of those odd paradoxes that you know yourself so well that you have no attachment to having to be a certain way or act a certain way. And if you're feeling happy, you know that you could just let go and be happy, and that's okay. If you feel like laughing, you can do that. If you feel like being solemn, you can do that. And, you have no attachment to having to have a certain mood or emotion at a given time. You just shift and change. You started to go into a little bit, and I know as we've been talking here, we've been tapping into your first stage of what's in the, your book titled Your Essential Self, The Inner Journey to Authenticity and Spiritual Enlightenment. And I'd love to move a little more now into the second stage, and I think we've been tapping on that maybe a little bit. And the second stage you refer to, if I'm correct, the transformation into authenticity.
Yeah. I mean, this is great. I'm just putting a talk together about the void of this, the what I call the threshold of transformation. Because following the stage of wholeness we were just talking about, which comes after this penultimate stage of genuine forgiveness, this great acceptance of oneself can be enough. I think this is the first important thing to say just before moving to the second stage. It's very important to consider your, not just your potential, but your capacity as a human being, and to do it without judgment and without any criticism. And when you consider your capacity, it's to say, in a sense, you're looking at a destiny or how deep you will go or how high you will go, but not in any purgative or judgmental or, you know, negative, positive sense. It's just to say a flower is a flower is a flower, you know, a Richard is a Richard, a Jesse is a Jesse. You are what you are. When you look deep into your soul, deep inside, ask yourself, what is my capacity as a human being in this lifetime? And then for some people, what emerges out of the whole acceptance of oneself is the next stage of personal development, which I call the second stage or the stage of authenticity. And between the first and the second stage is a void. The void, as in, it's a threshold that you cross with no attachments whatsoever. Not even to a guide who's taking you that far, not even to any belief, certainly not memory or anticipation. And the most important point about entering the second stage is that it is entirely unself-conscious. This is tricky because, you know, people sometimes say to me, look, am I in the second stage or am I getting into the second stage? And I have to say, when you've forgotten about it, you're, you know, quite likely, you know, maybe we'll see, you know, because what I've noticed in my work with people is they move through this void because, you know, this model of mine is not a hypothesis. It's not something I sort of thought up. It's something I've experienced, and I've experienced with many other people. And what happens is they turn to me with this sort of brightness in their eyes and they say, it's happened, isn't it? And I say, yep. And we know that they have now entered into a whole new life. The other remark is, when's it going to happen? When's it going to happen? You know, what I have to do to make it happen? And just say, well, just do what you're doing. Just let it go. Try and forget about it. Because you move across this void or this threshold with nothing. It has to be absolutely nothing. It's not to say you won't have some, not attachments, but you won't have your character and, you know, your physicality and certain amount of psychology once you've made this move, but you move into the second stage with no attachments whatsoever and no self-consciousness of the act or the movement or the transformation. If you're conscious of self, it is, of course, not happening, because the definition is you leave the self behind. Or to put it more accurately, you leave the attachment to yourself behind. And then in the second stage, what you're involved in is a whole new relationship, certainly to other people, but to the world around you, and that is that it is not separate from yourself. And you experience that, and you express that, and you're encouraged by your teacher, if you have one, and you probably should have one at this point, to express compassion by leading a life centered in the heart. And one of the things you know about the heart is it's not divisive. You know that your mind is always divisive. That's how it can be so creative and endlessly fascinating. But the heart is just this wellspring of love and acceptance, because it doesn't separate. It doesn't divide. There is no conflict. And the heart always informs you wisely and very, very immediately. So living the life from this new center is of immense importance to the individual, of course, because what's happening now is you can experience happiness and joy of a depth and a kind that you never could before in the first stage, when it was all relative. And when however long you were happy, you know you're going to be miserable sooner or later You know, happiness will lead to unhappiness and vice versa, because that's the nature of personality and the conflictual life. But in this second stage, it's just a development of an inner joy as you center yourself in the heart. And one of the things I wanted to say about this second stage, because it's so relevant to the message in your introduction, is I see the second stage as being not just an individual movement, but a collective movement, a global movement, a movement of humanity into the fourth chakra, if you will, to center ourselves in the heart, which is higher than the first three chakras, because we rise out of fear and desire and greed and the need for survival and all these kinds of things. And we move into a higher state of consciousness where we essentially really care. And, you know, one of the things, just, you know, when you get really practical about the world, is you see these terrible things happening on mass scale or individual scale, and we're horrified when we look at what a human being can do to another human being, to be so thoughtless, to be so violent and unfeeling. And these things are happening, you know, they're happening around us and they're happening in the world today. But alongside the reality of those facts is, I believe, an extraordinarily powerful intuition that we have now collectively, that it's time to really care. Not just about yourself, not just about your family and your close friends, not even just about your community and the people who are important to you, but to care in an expansive way that moves outward, 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 and becomes global and becomes universal and becomes ultimately cosmic and is ultimately spiritual, of a very higher consciousness. And when you reach that higher consciousness through, in time, this second stage, then the symptoms of not living in that consciousness, I'm convinced, will be healed.
And that is a really different perspective for people to grasp. And it's interesting, a couple of weeks ago when I had Dr. Neil Cobran on, and he talked about some of these same things in the aspect of we're so concerned a lot of times about stages and how do we just move through the steps. And when we talk about these types of processes, it's not about just moving through the steps. It's not like going to school where, okay, you take X amount of classes and here's your diploma. It's a very different way, because it's about experiencing. It's about actually, as you say, moving into the heart area. And when you're living from that heart area, you're not sitting there necessarily worrying about what might happen tomorrow or what's going to come crashing down or things like that. You're looking at things and you're realizing, yes, this is something that's happening in life. Yes, this is something that is devastating. And it's not devastating on this one level, it's devastating on many levels. And letting your heart continue to genuinely go out, not just because society says, hey, you should feel bad for these people that this particular incident happened to, but because you genuinely feel it.
That's right. We had here, a party back along, and I met somebody who, like me, is a Scorpio, astrologically, and I said to her, you know, and your only concern is death, isn't it? And she was totally amazed. And I said, well, it's just so obvious, you know, that's what we're like. And this is true of my life since I can remember, even beginning to think I was obsessed with death, and I remain obsessed with death. And the important thing about that obsession with death, whether you have it as a given which I do and which Scorpionic people tend to have, is that only when you confront the fear of death can you really express the compassion we're talking about that will lead to global change. And one of the reasons for that is because you step outside of time. You know, what death has done, or an orientation to death, is it orientates us to time. And it makes us think there isn't anything other than a time-constricted existence. Spirituality, on the other hand, refers to the absolute, it refers to the timeless or the immaterial condition. And that is a birthright of every human being. I mean, that's somewhere for you and I to occupy. And from that great power, then, we can manifest compassion or real love or the heart-filled, heart-centered life in space and time. But you can't do it from within the relative space-time continuum. And that's why the second stage is all about that learning, really. It's learning to say, well, you know, when it comes right down to it, fear is in the way of love. Fear is the opposite of love. Fear prohibits me from expressing compassion. And so how do I transcend fear and ultimately transcend my fear of death? Because I exist in time, but I also exist outside of time. And when you know that, when that's really clear to you, you can be timeless here in space and time, and then I believe compassion is possible, and it's not possible without it, because there's always going to be a part of you, or perhaps I should say that a bit. I mean, compassion is possible without it, but absolute compassion isn't possible without it, because there's always that part of you that's still afraid, that's still scared, that still somehow believes in evil, that still somehow thinks that the darkness will in time triumph over the light, and it's simply not true. But to experience that that's not true, you have to go to the ultimate fear, which is the fear that I will not exist, which is manifest in the screen of death.
And I feel like that is something where we really know where we're shifting into living as a soul as opposed to simply living as a human being, because it's the ego that's making us, I would say the ego or the human self that's leading us to be afraid of death, because the soul has no fear of it, I would say.
That's right. Absolutely. So the body is dead already. It is activated. It is inhabited. It is filled. It is life-filled by the soul, sometimes called the self or the essence. So the essence is kind of like the batteries or the spirit, or it inhabits the physical form, which in itself has no particular significance without that. It will be here for a while, and then it'll die. And I mean, that's the great insight of Advaita Vedanta at the moment, which is, at least in my world, is kind of sweeping people's spirituality. I mean, people are very interested in Advaita Vedanta because of these kinds of insights. And they're very deep insights, and they're very important insights. I don't believe that they're ultimate, but they're very important insights. Which is that which is here temporarily, is merely temporary. And in that sense, what we're mostly concerned with almost all the time is merely temporary. It doesn't mean don't be present and be involved with those things. But, you know, we fall into despair sometimes, and we fall into disillusionment sometimes, and all of that. And that, if we don't have something greater than that, which we can have, not easily, but we can have through developed awareness, through a spiritual consciousness, we can have that, then that disillusionment or despair is very hard to fall into, because you see that everything in front of you is changing all the time. I mean, it's all being born and it's all dying, but that's not all there is. And that's the most important thing, because in the heart, you can live that truth. And I believe that that truth will heal not only your individual life and the life of your family and friends, but the life ultimately of all.
I agree, and it is a... It's very funny. I did an experiment years ago in college where I had a teacher that was always trying to find an exercise I hadn't done before. And they did this one exercise of putting spotlights on everybody, and it was basically the situation of, okay, you've crashed somewhere, and you're being held hostage, and everybody can go but one person, and whoever stays is most likely going to die. And the teacher looks at me and he says, have you done this exercise? I said, no, I haven't done this exercise. And he says, okay, so now you guys got to figure out, you know, who's going to stay and probably die. And it was funny because the aspect behind it is most people don't want to die. And so he goes, okay, start. And we had like the whole class to do it. And I said, okay, I volunteer to stay. Everybody else can go. And the whole hand, everybody's hands went up, and my group goes, we're done. And I thought my teacher was just going to have a heart attack right there. He was like, you told me you hadn't done this. And I said, I haven't. And he said, how can you possibly be done? And the whole group says, she volunteered to stay, and we said, okay. So then they had to spend the rest of the class, you know, and analyzing why I was willing to stay. And my response was that I live from this philosophy that, yes, of course my family would be sad and things like that, but I live with no regrets. And, yes, I've made mistakes, and, yes, if I had the knowledge now and the chance to repeat something, I'd do it differently on some things, but I have no regrets. So if I die at any time, it's not a fear for me. It's just something that I accept. It's going to happen eventually anyway. And I thought that poor teacher was just going to give up teaching almost at that point. But it is that concept of just realizing that it's okay. It's okay when you get into that point. Now, you mentioned here also, moving on, you have a third stage, which you've referred to as the source of consciousness. Mm. Tell us about that.
The first thing I'd like to say about the third stage and what's so important about it is that it is the beginning of the spiritual path. And I say that because we've been talking about some wonderful things. In the first stage and the second stage, there's many wonderful things. But, you know, that's how wonderful we are as people, as personalities, as individuals. I consider the second stage of compassion, authenticity, and transformation to be the natural flow of an individual human life. So I call it the flowering of the individual. What that means is we're not really used to flowering individuals at the moment. We should be. We could be, hopefully we will be soon. But the second stage is still merely a culmination of personal work. The third stage is the beginning of spiritual practice per se, in earnest, in seriousness. And therefore the first two stages, if you enter the third stage, have been preparation merely. It's to say at the end of the second stage, you finish second stage awareness, but you actually now begin the work of truth. Because, you know, spirituality is a serious endeavor. I mean, we have now in 50 years, 60 years, since we were exposed to these ideas here in the West, I mean the serious ideas which came from the East, we've been exposed to people who practiced meditative awareness consciousness techniques that we would go and do on retreat, or we do on retreat, or we do for 20 minutes a day, or, you know, 10 minutes, or we think of occasionally. But here were people, the spiritual masters from the East coming, who started and didn't stop. I mean, they were doing it for the whole of their lives. It's a very serious business, spirituality, and we move through spiritual stages of transcendence and divinity, which themselves can be talked about, have been talked about for thousands of years. I think we need to find a way to talk about it that makes some sense to us today, and not talk down in any way, but make accessible the deep truths and the deep facts of spiritual life, spiritual practice. And third stage, therefore, is a description of what we do with transcendent experience, how we have transcendent experience, what it means, what it's about, how we shed it, how we constantly let go, and ultimately merge with the divine in this lifetime, and what relationship that can have to functioning. You know, that we are here as individual human beings, and yet we have the capacity and we have the potential for this third stage awakening, for this genuine spiritual, in contrast, and in my book, this contrast with soulful awakening, because the work of the soul, in my definition in the book, is the work of your relationship to Earth, or your relationship to the relative plane, time and space and so on, into relationships, into dependency and all of that. Whereas in the third stage, the spirit, of course, is more to do with higher chakras, is more to do with looking up, really, and the light of the divine actually in your life. So it's a there's an order, shall we say. There's a soulful awakening, there's a spiritual awakening, and they're not the same.
Yeah. And so, maybe share with us a little bit about how they differ, then.
Yeah. They differ because, really, you know, to be soulful, you don't really have to be spiritual at all. You know, I know, and I'm sure you know, and I'm sure listeners are aware of wonderful people, compassionate people, deep people, and people you love to be around and you evoke when you think of qualities like, you know, kindness and attention and love, who may be atheistic, who may have no spiritual bent whatsoever. And this is literally true. It's true that you can be a very fine person, a very loving person, a very caring person, without resorting to any spiritual practice or even having any spiritual awareness. It doesn't change the fact that if we have a spiritual tendency, we don't see everybody within the spiritual context. But then we have to look at people who would deny spirituality altogether, who are just behaving wonderfully well. I mean, they're just bright and they're light and they're alive. And they're not simply self-important or self-obsessed. And they are certainly walking their talk, but they're doing everything that you'd expect of a spiritual person. This is the soulful qualities. This is the development of the soul to a degree where the person resonates, feels with, has attention for other people and the outside world, and that shows in their life. And the development of the soul has been so confused, I believe, with the development of the spirit, that it's hard for a lot of us to see behind that veil and see that spirit isn't soul. Of course, they're simply words and they've been used interchangeably. But the way in which I would use them, I think that this reflects a reality, and a deep, important reality, is the soul is a looking down. We look down and we are of the earth. this word soul, which is, you know, has this dual meaning of it's the bottom of the feet, as well as it's something that inhabits the body, that's very relevant. It is our contact or our connection to the earth. It's our very ground. And the grounded individual who cares and is awake and is selfless, even, is themselves highly developed in the soul. That soul development takes place in my second stage of awakening, of seeing that life is not just about separation and conflict, it's about evoking and expressing compassion in everyday life. It's a soulful development. But you can then have the spiritual development, which is something else, whereby the personal and the soulful stages of consciousness now become a foundation, a deep foundation, a solid, stable foundation for the development of spiritual consciousness. And one of the things I'd refer people listening to about this is the fact that when you look at spirituality from point of view of account, from the Gospels to the life of Buddha, on through, what you'll notice is quite curious is that spirituality is almost mostly psychology, actually. For example, in 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, we have in the Gospels that Christ receives these various temptations and so forth and so forth. It's essentially a psychological motif. You know, that you and I are tempted with and can succumb to any time. You know, worldly power or pursuit of money, and et cetera, et cetera. Or the things that would deviate us from the truth or deviate us from our soulful or spiritual practices. It's the same in the life of Buddha. It's the same when you read the life of realized masters, the great men and women through time who have merged with infinite love. They have grappled with their personal psychology. Therefore, their spiritual biographies are more psychology than spirituality. I think what this tells us is that spirituality is behind a veil. It's behind a veil of self. That unless you penetrate through that veil, in terms of self-knowledge and soul development, you can't even have a vision of it. You can't even really see what it could mean. And so the real depths of sadhana or the real depths of spiritual practice in your life are extraordinarily profound, and they will lead you to many choices, choices to be made from the heart, very intelligent choices that you have to make about how to live, and more than anything, making spiritual practice the very center of your life. So these are is some summary of what the third stage is about.
Okay. And I think that there, for some people, there could be a little bit of confusion as far as what it means to put the spiritual at the center of life. There, to have that be the main focus, or to, you know, as you said, practice.
I think one helpful way, or one way in which because it's helpful to ground it in physical life, is to consider the energy system, the chakra system, and consider your experience of that. You know, a lot of us have read books on energy systems and chakras and so on, and a lot of us know what the heart or the solar plexus, the lower chakra area, the throat, the forehead, and all the third eye, and all of this, what they're meant to represent. But what I find much more helpful to all of us is to, you know, if I have a workshop, I won't teach the energy system and talk about it in terms of abstract concepts, but rather direct people's awareness into these different areas of the body. So, well, what is there? You know, what is your awareness of your throat? What is the actual experience of the heart or the solar plexus? What kinds of feelings do you have there? What kind of experience do you have of it? And very often what you have is something which is contracting or constricting or in some ways in the way, which can be seen as a symbol of some sort. And then you can work with, well, you know, if you feel like you've got a rope around your neck and so you can't express yourself, and you can't be assertive, et cetera, et cetera. You know, what can you do with that? You know, what can it mean to heal that in some way? Can you loosen that rope? This kind of thing. You work with the symbols and you work with the energy system as a present experience. And when you do that and you reach the higher aspects of the energy system, so the third eye, the center of spiritual intuition, spiritual vision, and then, of course, the crown chakra, then you have a sense of what this third stage is about. You have a real experience of what this third stage is about. If you can live from the higher chakras, not only the seventh and the crown chakra, the Sahasrara, but further, the ninth chakra, beyond the physical form, then it gives you a whole new perspective, of course, on the world and the world of appearances and the world of relative time and space and, you know, relationships and all everything that mostly we're obsessed with from the lower aspects of the energy system. So it takes a lot of courage. It feels like you're leaving the world behind in a way, because in a sense you do. You leave the world behind to inhabit the world of the spirit. And then in time, you return to the world, but with that spiritual sensibility. And consciousness then will reveal the world of appearances in a totally different way. You see the truth in everything. And of course, you see the compassion in everything. And that's so difficult to even talk about when it's not a reality, because you haven't arrived there. So the spiritual practice is about that. It's about developing, expanding, lightening, enlightening, and going further to merge with the divine. You realize your divinity. That's what the third stage is about.
And I appreciate you for clarifying that, because I think for some people, you know, there is not a complete understanding. And I would add too, and I believe this is part of what's in your work, it is really about being in that present moment. You're aware that there are things that are going to happen tomorrow or next year or whenever, but your focus is what is happening with you right at this moment. Your focus is an ongoing awareness, and no matter what you're doing, whether you're sitting quietly, whether you're at the grocery store getting groceries or whatever it is, there's this ongoing just awareness of everything about you, the feeling of what's coming in. It's about listening to the intuition. It's that constant awareness. It's like a light that's constantly turned on.
Yes, Jesse, that's it. I mean, that's a big step for us all. It's a big step to stay aware and to be present in the moment. And what I would add to that is, and hopefully this is clarifying rather than anything else, is there is, you are also timeless. You know, you are also outside of time. And that step that you take into present awareness, which is so difficult because, you know, we fear, so difficult because we conflict, so difficult because we're frustrated or dissatisfied or we're seeking or searching for something, we're restless. It's so difficult to be present. But you can develop that awareness practice over time, and so you're increasingly immersed in the present moment. And then there's a further stage, and that's into the awareness of the timelessness of yourself. You are timeless as well as participating in time. And then that step into the present awareness itself is a foundation. It's not a be-all and an end-all. We didn't do all of this just so we can be present in the middle of changing conditions. We become present in the midst of changing conditions so that we can take this ultimate step. And the ultimate step is to realize the deathlessness of yourself in this life.
And I'm glad that you brought up the timelessness factor again, because that is something that is so hard for people to grasp, especially when they are living on schedules and deadlines and looking at life saying, I only have so many working years left or things. And it's okay to acknowledge that that may be the case, but life doesn't end just because this body gives out.
Yeah.
Our existence doesn't end because the body gives out. And we see it in a smaller scale cycle. You know, your life doesn't end because your car stops working. Mm. You get a new car. Life doesn't end because the body stops working. You may choose to find another body. To go through, and something bringing it kind of full circle back in that concept of timelessness is that we, gosh, I was right there. is that it just doesn't, our spirit or our soul is what's keeping the body going, not the other way around. So, you know, if we remove the body, it's still there. It's still in existence. It's what gives the body life versus the body giving it life. And I guess, that's where I was headed with it, coming full circle around, because that's what you had mentioned earlier in the evening.
And rather like what we were talking about previously, whereby when you are in a higher state of spiritual consciousness, you are still developed in your individuality, or you still express a great character, a unique self. It's also true that knowing that you are beyond space and time, you take space and time very, very, very seriously.
Mm-hmm.
All moments are precious. In some ways, it's become for me a spiritual gauge. You know, when you meet people who are spiritual teachers, and one of the things that I'm interested in is exactly that, is how they are. In you see and you intuit the authenticity of the spiritual attainment in another through how they deal with that moment, or how they deal with, you know, some carelessness or something. And over here, in the center, for example, I remember a time I was, and I'd been giving a talk in a workshop, in a course here, and talking about exactly this. And then somebody saw me, because we have some land here and we have some animals and, you know, some crops and small holdings and whatnot. And somebody saw me, I was upset with something, I forget what it was now, but something hadn't happened in the right way, and I had raised my voice. And so they took me aside the next day and said, I saw you yesterday, I mean, I just don't believe you anymore, because you said that, you know, it's beyond space and time and that's your real self and it really all doesn't matter and so on, and there you are getting upset about a, you know, delivery of hay or something. And I had to explain, I had to cover myself on that one, I had to explain, I had to explain that that's how it manifests. I mean, I see that with everyone who's got this. I don't see anybody who understands that we are timeless We're deathless. We're entirely free and liberated, and then is really casual with life and time and material. In fact, the opposite. And so whenever I come across these stories, I try and remember them. I usually forget them, but you behave as if it is the most important thing, because it is. Even the smallest thing is most important. And I mean, the story that comes to mind, for some reason I rather like it, is spiritual teacher Rudolf Steiner. And when he was particularly respected, he was a big talk that he was giving, and this is recorded in a book. And before he gave it, he looked down, he noticed someone had presumably thrown a piece of waste paper and missed the basket. And so he went across the podium on the stage or whatever it was to rectify, to pick the thing up and just to put it away. And some assistant or some listener in the front row or sitting alongside him said, Herr Steiner, you don't have to do, I'll do that. You carry on, I'll do that. And he said, no. He said, if I don't go and do that, there's no point in anything I'm going to say. Which is an extraordinary thing to say, but of course makes absolute sense. He had to go pick up the piece of paper and put it in the bin. The smallest thing was the most important thing. And if he had launched into his talk without doing that, he would have lost all credence in his own eyes. And right. So this to me is a very deep truth. It's a very deep truth that every moment is important of life. One treats it very, very preciously. There is a great wisdom in age. I'm in the 60s now, and that's a very different perspective on life. And I phoned up my astrologer from years ago, and I said, I want you to help me. I want to know when I'm going to die. And he said, well, I don't want to do that. And I said, I need you to tell me when I'm going to die. Because he said, why? I said, I've got loads of books. And this last book took me 12 years. The first book took me 21 years. I've got about 4 on the go now. And I reckon I may be a bit doolally by the time I'm in my 80s. And I need to know, Anyway, I didn't get anywhere with that. He refused on that one. But I really wanted to know, And for the first time when I hit 60, I put in a place, a 20-year plan, which I partly I do lightly and I partly do seriously, because I really would like to fulfill a destiny, shall we say. And I'm enormously inspired to share and to talk and to write. And suddenly all the moments become precious. If I can't fulfill 2,000-3,000 words in a day, it's like I'm really not doing what I could do. And I consider each moment precious.
And I'm chuckling and I'm laughing here because I completely understand that. And some people will say to me and go, I just don't understand why you're doing this or why you're working so hard or things like that. And of course there's multiple reasons there, but at the same time it's like, because as you say, basically because every moment is precious.
Yes.
And I could worry everything to death, or I could sit there and say, this is reaching my potential today.
Yes.
And yes, I have to remember to balance things and to not work constantly, but it is that interesting dichotomy of when you reach timelessness and you stop worrying about time so much, that at the same time your senses are so heightened. It's like when you let go of everything, at the same time your senses are so heightened, you're so sensitive that you realize how valuable each one of those seconds are.
I think the the ultimate thing, perhaps we could say, that's a big thing to say, so I don't know about that, but let's try this, let's see how it comes out, is in human development, is in the development of self-knowledge and awareness and compassion and the heart-filled life and the soul and spirit development, is to arrive at a state where you surrender wholly to the divine and you really say, you know, work through me. I mean, just, you know, what is it that's required? What do I need to do? And rather than do what you want to do, which is never fulfilling, not purely doing what you want to do, but rather being available to what is possible and what can come through you, has an enormous joy in it and incredible energy in it. What you have to let go to it fully, of course, but there is nothing like the experience of letting go and not knowing. You know, and I've been doing these online courses and giving talks to people all around the world, and someone, and you have questions and answers at the end of the talk, and someone said, you know, where's all this stuff come from? And I said, I have no idea. You know, I compose my talk a few days before the talk, and then I sit there and I, like this, you know, with headphones on, talking to people. It's a wonderful thing about technology, all over the place. You know, so we have people all around the world who can converse with each other through these online discourses. And, you know, I would have talked for an hour and 20 minutes, and sometimes it's longer than that. And I'm listening to it as well. You know, I think this is good, I like this, or, you know, don't know what that means, or whatever it is, the same as the listener. And they said, well, how do you do it? I said, I just, you know, I just put up a blank page and I just do it. And then I correct it a bit with the grammar and so I can actually deliver it. And then I'm listening to it the same as you. And that is immensely pleasurable to me because I'm not in the way. You know, I'm not thinking about those obvious things like how can I impress or how can I say something deep. I just take the title of whatever it is that comes, and then this immense amount of material comes, and then I have to put an end to it, and there's a talk. So this, for me anyway, this is what it's all been about. You know, all these decades of work and working with people and, you know, everything that I've done has come to this place where you just sit back, really. It's sort of easy in a way, and you get out of the way. Mm-hmm. And it's also, it's hard work, but work and joy, work and happiness, there's not a dichotomy anymore.
And that's where that hard work is effortless.
It's effortless.
You're
yeah.
out of the way. You're in that flow.
There's nothing like being out of the way. Yeah.
you get hurt a lot less when you're out of the way.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're not bumped around so much. Richard, we're really winding down here. It just always amazes me. It's the how the time goes. I think I kind of trance when I'm in my show a little bit because I'm just so there in the moment. And the next thing I look up and it's like, oh, the time is gone. Is there anything that you have coming up event-wise? You've got an amazing website for people, which is www.therapyandspirituality.com. You've got some great questions on there for people that is all about life, that they can go in and see your answers and your responses to. Do you have some events yeah. coming up? I know you've got your center there in Spain.
Yeah, I do. We do. I have, just to say, I'm very proud of the website, but my friend Peter designed the website, and he was just wonderful. And I think what he did is something I hoped for, which is a website that works, you know, where you can look at it and you know where you're going, and you can go to the questions or the articles. And sometimes I've been criticized for putting too much on it. There's an immense amount of material on it, but I'm very proud of what he did in designing it so well so that it works. The new events are many, but in summary, there's a new online course, which is what I was just talking about, which is discourses where I give a talk, and then we have questions and answers online, and that's a new series coming up in about 4.5 weeks. It's coming up. It's called the Silent Thunder Discourses. The other big event that's coming up is the first training in sacred attention. Sacred attention is a new kind of therapy based on the three stages, based on the book Your Essential Self. And I'm going to give the course over a week so that it's feasible for people to come in from around the globe, because, you know, there's people interested in my work all over, and it's I don't think we can do this as weekends or days. So we're going to have a full week, and probably a full week later on in the year, in the first training for sacred attention, which is awareness technique both for yourself and also if you're a practitioner for working with other people. The other big event, of course, is the release of the book, which is great, which is July the 8th. It'll finally be available.
Wonderful. And I encourage people to check that out, because I know you've given us probably a very small taste of what's in there tonight, and it's exciting, and I think this is definitely going to be something that is going to help a lot of people out there. And I'd like to just say thank you so much for your time. And we've been talking tonight with Richard Harvey. He has been sharing with us his work in therapy and spirituality. He has been discussing the principles in his books, both The Flight of Consciousness and Your Essential Self, which, as he just mentioned, will be released July 8th. It's being done through Llewellyn Publications, as well as other concepts that he addresses. If you've missed any part of this show, I encourage you to go back and listen to it in the archive, because, wow, lots of information here tonight. You can learn again more about his work, the upcoming events. Check out that question section, because he addresses some pretty intense questions on there, and he's got some incredible events going on. That's on his website, therapyandspirituality.com. And again, Richard, I just really appreciate you being here with us.
Jesse, thanks so much for inviting me, and you know, it's been a great pleasure. Really, thank you.
Thank you. And next week here on Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour, I am going to be having Francois Netter on my show. She will be sharing with us her work in creating psychological shifts and healing through dance and movement. So that's going to be a really unique show and a unique concept that I'll be bringing in. My next set of books, which are based on relationships, will be available for purchase soon. I'm just down to the final stages on it, so I appreciate everybody hanging in there, bearing with me on it, and it's going to be a great look at different components of relationships. I do have a monthly special. May, I've decided to go ahead and extend my book specials for Activating Compassion and Activating Compassion, the workbook. If you just go straight onto my website at www.jessieannnicholsgeorge1.com, you'll find the specials, the promotional codes are there, the links are there. And what I've got is the books are available at $3.99, they're regularly $12.99, and the ebook versions are available for only $1.99, which are regularly $9.99, and there's no limit on how many copies that you can get. So it's a great time to take advantage of it, and that will be available through May 31st for you. I also want to mention that we've got several shows right here on Main Street Universe throughout the week. Sunday nights, we have Darren Bouquet, who's a reader at Madame Louveau in New Orleans, doing his Spiritual Insight show. Monday nights, we have Kevin Baird walking on the sidewalk with his Horizon Oracle Journeys deck, which is a deck that he created himself. Tuesdays, we have Mary Phelan. She does a show called Inner Wisdom, and Mary has other things going on, including her own TV show, so I encourage you to check that out as well. Wednesday nights is our flagship show, and we have Danielle and Janice on, hosting that show together. Janice, our female hostess there, and Danielle, who's been with the show from the very beginning. And then, of course, right here on Friday nights, we have Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour. Incredible lineup of guests coming up. Like I said, whew, I'm so lucky on this. I'm so blessed to have wonderful people like Richard Harvey. If you've enjoyed the show tonight, please do share it with other people. Share it with your social media, your friends, your family, anybody that you think might enjoy this information, because this is great learning here. And my name is Jessie Ann Nichols George. I want to thank you so much for being here tonight, and I look forward to seeing you back here next week as we delve more into activating compassion. And I'm going to be leaving you tonight with the song Yearning For, otherwise known as Over and Over by Shem Shai. And I just want to say thank you so much, and I look forward to seeing you again next week right here on Activating Compassion in the Midnight Hour. May you enjoy the rest of your weekend and have an amazing week.
And if I could see what makes me blind, I would soar to the edge of my mind. And to touch what seems unreal, just to show you the way that I feel. And we are in time with time, one with season of change and size. And we are in tune with the tune, caught in a balance of sun and moon. Oh, deep inside, the light within, shining to show you it's here to begin. When all I have is all I need, I will soar to the edge of eternity.
Love is still burning deep in your spirit, your heart is still